The town may be kind of small, but these folks have big smiles and big hearts. And they know what it is to have simple fun down our way, where old-fashioned singing and homey gatherings make living mighty pleasant.
What a crazy place in American culture that guy had. You know, his whole gig was just doing crazy shit and failing like most of the time. Like,
yeah, my little wind up Evel Knievel thing had a higher success rate.
But he was so badass, the white jumpsuit, you know.
Dave Rolling.
Welcome to Abandoned Albums, the documentary podcast where we take a closer look at some albums that may have been forgotten about over time, some albums you might not know existed, and some albums by up-and-coming artists we think you should know about. I'm your host, Keith R. Higgins.
The paper doesn't give many details. Tell me about this.
On this episode of Abandoned Albums, Steve Isaac stopped by Thunderlove Studios to chat about his career. Now, Steve is one of those guys that just generates positivity. There are those people who, when they drop their toast, it always lands butter side up. Steve is one of those guys. From the burgeoning coffee house scene in the early 90s that he helped shape in Los Angeles, to being a VJ at MTV, to traveling with a Broadway musical, to fronting not one but two rock and roll bands, the second of which was three quarters of a legendary band. Oh yeah, he's also a web and graphic designer, and a father. He's also a really nice guy. Here's my conversation with Steve Isaacs.
Good to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well. Are you, you're in Los Angeles then, yeah?
Yes. Yeah, the valley. Toluca Lake.
Oh, it's lovely out there.
Just suburban enough to kind of not drive you crazy with the LA of it all. It's, yeah.
Did you grow up in California?
Yeah, Northern California. Okay. And then moved to Los Angeles when I was 18, and then have basically been in Los Angeles my whole life, except for a couple jaunts in New York, and that's it.
Your first TV appearance was on a show called Starcade.
Yeah.
And it, which, for those who don't know, is a television show where it televised kids playing arcade games against each other. So my question is, what was your arcade game?
That I played on the show, or just my favorite arcade game, period?
That you played on the show.
Yeah, on the show. Sadly, like, okay, so they let you play. You had to, each round, you had to pick from a bank of, like, I think 5 or 6 arcade games they had in the studio. So you had to pick one and then play a round and then try to beat the other person. And I had, like, an okay initial showing, and then little Robbie, I think his name was Robbie, just started decimating me. And I made the rookie mistake of, in the green room, we were talking about what games we like did and didn't like. And I was like, oh, you know what I really suck at? I really suck at Moon Patrol. Oh, I hate that game. And what game did he pick to push me out of the competition? Moon Patrol, that's right. It was one of the 5 or 6 that was on the stage. So it was kind of a crying shame. I think it was like Burger Time, The Journey Escape video game.
Oh my God.
Soundtrack. And they're like, they had like big journey heads and little bodies cruising around. And then Moon Patrol, sadly, was, and I never played Moon Patrol ever again. That was it.
Wow.
Bad vibe.
That bastard, little Robbie.
Ugh. I think Nairobi, Robbie Niobe or something. Oh yeah. But no, that was smart. That was, you know, that was bad. Good gamesmanship on his part. Smart utilizing my weakness and me, just a bad rookie move.
And now for something completely different.
You go out east to become a VJ. What was that like at the dawn of grunge? You're on MTV.
So got this audition to try out to be a VJ. And I thought, holy crap. Like, at that point, MTV was like, it was youth culture. It was incredibly important. You know, people would just turn it on and leave it on all the time, and you could actually discover music. And at that point, it was really hair metal, huge hair metal. And then like kind of pop hip hop, like the beginnings of pop hip hop, MC Hammer, Vanilla Ice, and then just like big radio songs, Whitney Houston, things like that. So it was a lot of that. And MTV, their curse was they'd play the same thing for hours and hours and hours and hours a day. So the month, I think after I got to MTV and after my first couple of VJ segments, Nirvana broke.
This is Steve Isaacs. There's a new band called Nirvana. Actually, they're not that new. They had an album that was independently released, but their major label debut is called Nevermind. And Nirvana is a Seattle band, and they're causing a lot of stir in the music industry, partly because of this brand new video. You can see a high school rally going psycho, and it's a lot of fun, and it's a great tune. Why don't you check this out? This is Nirvana topping the college charts with Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Holy shit, what is this? And it really was like a tidal wave. It was a tidal wave at the offices. It was a tidal wave for, like, I'd go out and like have drinks at a bar and I'd hear Smells Like Teen Spirit. And then you'd go to like some like dance club, like Danceteria or some like place where they play dance music. And they'd be mixing Nirvana into that. It was this instantaneous, all of a sudden, just this ubiquity of one song and one vibe that really counterbalanced the cheesiness of hair metal, because hair metal was super cheesy. So for me, I was very lucky that I was a musician. I got to MTV at a point where it was like questing to define youth pop culture. And when grunge happened, it was this like, yes, this is the next thing. How many bands can we put on the air? How many songs can we champion? And I got to be there right there when it was happening. So it was pretty magic and unforgettable and a lot of great memories.
Are you familiar with the theme of prescience that runs through your career? And I'll give you the examples that I found. In 1990, I mean, coffee was still, you know, in the Greek cups at the corner deli in New York.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
We didn't have coffee shops. Ones and Zeros, which is a nod to the future of society. The Napster trial.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Your career, as I noticed, as I looked at it, I'm like, you seem to be like 4 or 5 years ahead of everything. And I'm wondering, are you aware of that?
Yeah, I would say, yeah. I had a bit of like, I'd get it passionate about something and I'd get this weird feeling that this was somehow important or somehow different. And then a couple of years later, a year or two later, I'd really feel like, oh, wow, everybody's into the same thing. I wish I'd kind of leveraged that in some kind of a usable way, like a stock market or like futures. And so I can't really say any of it has necessarily been that profitable, but it did feel a little bit, without really trying, it was really more just like a little voice, like, oh, this is important. When I got into computers and the internet, it just felt like, oh, this is so super important. It's so important. Interesting observation. Well done. Thank you.
I remember going online in like the early 90s, and I worked at Barnes & Noble at the time, and a friend of mine was like, oh, you got to go on the internet, the World Wide Web. I'm like, how the fuck do you get on that? You got to put the thing in, dial up, and I'm like, ah, this is too much of a hassle. Exactly.
Yeah.
This seems like a big pain in the ass. Nobody's going to get on board with this. See, I did not have that sort of foresight that you did. I'm like, oh, well, fuck it.
For me, it was, kind of inauspicious in a way. But after MTV, I got a job in a play, right? So I'm singing the lead in this play, and I'd never done anything like it. It wasn't like being in a band, but it was like, it was probably the best time of my whole life. But I bought my first laptop, right? And so I was in a hotel room every night for a year and a half. So different cities, I'd be in a city for like a month. And then you're playing the play every night at like 7 o'clock, but all day long, you're killing time, like eating, walking around, checking out Boston or San Francisco. It was like great, super great experience to check out the country. But I had a lot of time to kill. So I got a laptop, was like, oh, holy crap. Like it was an Apple PowerBook 180C. So it was a color screen. It was about that big. And then I got my first drawing software, painting software, Painter. And I would draw using the trackpad, the trackball, because there's a trackball. And I would draw using that because it was before I had a graphics tablet. And I frigging loved it. And I just went, wow, I don't know what it is, but listening to music and doing graphics. And this is amazing. I love this. And then like, oh, what's AOL? And I think the first time I saw a girl, a bikini top girl, scrolling like a picture, like the JPEG, and it's like a pretty girl, and it was like, wait, this just showed up on my computer? What even the hell? Like it was it all started to come together in my mind that something like really big was afoot as far as like accepting content and then putting stuff out into the world. And and to this day, geez, it's all I do is stare at a screen, like a lot of us.
And for those listening, that little play that Steve mentioned is something called Tommy.
Yep.
That's a jump from being a singer-songwriter at a coffee shop, owning a coffee shop, becoming an MTV VJ, and then going on the road with what is arguably one of the biggest rock albums of all time and certainly one of the most popular Broadway musicals. You're like some sort of polymath.
jack of all trades, master of none, or just, you know, jack of all trades, or just jack off, whatever.
How did that come to be? Was it just sort of
another great piece of luck? MTV fires me. They don't renew my contract. So my boss at the time, I'd started to like not be the best employee. I was in my sweet spot when I was talking about music I personally liked, like when I talked about bands and when I thought like, oh, you know, you people at home, like I saw this band last night and they blew my mind. It was incredible. And da-da-da, I would get really excited and I'd really feel like it was like my job to help the bands that I personally thought were good. And then the band or the music that was just kind of like a big wash of commercial, buy this, it's a giant product. I thought it was my decision to make if I would champion music or not champion music on MTV. And that's not really why they hire you. That's not really the deal. You're supposed to just, it's an even playing field and here you go and everything. So, you know, I inevitably ran afoul of the MTV higher ups. So they terminate my contract. At that point, I thought, oh, you know, I just want to play my band anyway. I thought I'd like sold my soul to this opportunity. And I was like glad to be rid of it. I was all super happy. They believe it or not, that they terminated my contract. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to do my band, get back to music. And then at that point, I was in New York. I was playing with a band. They decided to move back to Los Angeles because they were friends of mine from Los Angeles. And Karen Duffy, who was one of the other VJs who we were super close. And she was just the sweetest, sweetest person. And she hits me up one day because I'm out in New York. I don't have anything to do. My band just left. I'm kind of like, oh, whoa, what's next? She's like, oh, I told my agent about this opportunity, the Broadway show Tommy, they're making a touring cast. And I told my agent to submit you for an audition. So you have an audition if you want it. And I was like, that's super freaking random, but I had nothing to do. And I loved the music. I always loved Pinball Wizard. And so I went and gave it a shot. Like at that point, I still had long hair. I'd never done any acting. I'd never done any Broadway, obviously. So I thought, this is not going to happen, but what the hell? I literally have nothing else happening career-wise. So I went and I'm in the hallway. And, you know, at this point, I'm not really nervous because I feel it's such an impossible. It's like there's no chance of getting this gig. And I hear the people that are trying out. I could hear through the door. And it was like, it's a Pinball Wizard, has to be a twist. Like super Broadway, coming at it real super, super Music Man feels, you know? And I'm like, oh man, I don't know. Why am I here? Like, look at my hair. What is this? This is, and I brought my fucking guitar. Like I brought a guitar. I didn't have like the piano music. I knew how to play it, right? So I just brought my damn acoustic. And I go and I sing it and I can, you know, handle that song. And they seem to be really nice, you know? And they're like, okay, cool. And they let me go. And then they called me back. And I was like, oh shit. Wait a minute, this could actually happen. If they're calling me back, it could actually happen. Maybe the thing that makes me different is a good thing, you know? And it's like, that's like life. A lot of us, you know, it's like, you think like, oh, I'm not right for this. I'm not right for this. But sometimes if you just lean into what makes you different and try not to portray yourself as somebody else, that's exactly what works. And you never know when those opportunities are, but that was one of them where I just kind of didn't give a fuck. I was like, you're not picking me. I know it, you know, whatever. I'm just going to play this song for you. I only know one song. But boom. So then kept going to auditions. And then there's like Pete Townsend was at the third one. I was like, oh, this is actually legitimately serious. Holy crap. He's like right there. And I was all nervous. But, you know, after a bunch of auditions, they gave me the gig and then toured. It was for like about 500 shows, a year and a half. And it was just absolute like, just way too lucky of a situation because it was a blast getting to work with those talented people, you know, go to Boston for like a month and a half and just live like a Bostoner and enjoy that feeling of like living that life there. And every night you get up, you sing and all these people are dancing and there's music and there's so many talented creative people working at the same time, trying to make one thing happen for 2 hours. Is a really miraculous thing. It's different than a band. A band is the same thing on a way different level, but there's, you know, artisans and stagecraft people and the band underneath are like the musicians underneath the stage are all incredibly virtuosic players, you know, like, so getting to be a part of that whole thing. And at the end, you just hear like some applause and you're done for the night. It was like, what an incredibly even exchange of you work really hard for a few hours. You hear some applause and you go put your head on the pillow and you're like, what a great day's work. You know, it was fun.
The amount of moving pieces going on at a Broadway, in a Broadway musical are just,
it's insane.
Yeah. I mean,
they don't always work. We were touring and the Tommy stage was known for being like a really visually very technologically challenging piece of work. Cause all of the set pieces were on these tracks and the sets would just go, and like it would be, you know, like just, you know, a backdrop and a wall and then a thing hanging from the sky, and it would all go on tracks going, and it was all computer timed to cues. And if you were in front of a piece, if you were in the wrong place, you would just get mowed down or pushed, or you could be hurt really bad because there was no real safety. Didn't work like that. You had to kind of be deal with your own safety. So they used to swing me around on a foy rig for like some flying scenes. And I kept getting slammed into pieces of stage work that would like be coming on the stage. And I'd go, yippee doodle, I have a pinball whip. And then it'd like be taken off. So there was some like kind of, you know, tricky injury, just some, you know, didn't get injured too bad, but they had to take out the flying parts because it was a little dangerous.
From what you're saying, it's sort of, you went on a rock and roll tour just in a Broadway fashion.
Yeah, that was and then when I was done with it, was, you know, went back to Los Angeles and went back to, you know, the same old thing. Like, I was like, it's time to start a band. It's time to get a new thing together. Cause all I really wanted to do was make albums and kind of, at that point I'd really felt like, wow, I'm so lucky. I've gotten to check out these things, but I thought that I'd really been pushing off and potentially sacrificing my ability to like do what I really wanted to do. Cause I kept doing these other things. So I was really like fortunate. And I think I was just a kid. So I think I had some level of gratitude, but not an appropriate level. Now looking back, just kind of like a brash, selfish, like everything good is going to happen to me no matter what I do. Kind of a, you know, idiot approach to it. I think I would appreciate things more now, but I did feel at that point like, hey man, I'm like 24, 25. Like it's time to really like have my band with my songs. What am I doing here? Is it just going to be another diversion? And then when I came back to Los Angeles and made Skycycle.
I watch too much TV. It's probably genetic. Guess it's sort of pathetic how I waste my time. And in my darkest hour, I wanna feel so heroic. Even a mile from Han Solo would be fine with me. And you were the one that I was waiting for. You were the one that I was waiting for. It's a little like chess. The good pieces taken. Maybe I was mistaken, and a deadbeat I'll stay. And about then I feel full of careless abandon. I can jump Snake River Canyon with some space to spare. And you were the one that I was waiting for.
For those who don't know, it's named after even if anyone listening remembers Evel Knievel, you know? And I remember that. Was it Snake River Jump? Is that what it was?
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Yeah. Like, yeah. What a crazy place in American culture that guy had, you know? His whole gig was just doing crazy shit and failing, like, most of the time. Like, you would watch these pay-per-view things, and he would jump, and he would like destroy his body and he would be screwed up and that was it. You know, congratulations. He didn't really totally have huge successful winning jumps most of the time, from what I can understand.
No, from what I remember, it was like epic fails on national television.
What a job.
It's like, you know, and
but he was so badass, the white jumpsuit, you know.
The cane. And we lived in Canada at the time, and this is the one where he was jumping over the pool of sharks. And
yeah, so amazing.
And, you know, and he wrecked coming down, had to go to the hospital. But it's just, I was thinking about that just recently. I'm like, he didn't have a good success ratio from what I recall.
You know? if I had to pick, at least from my growing up, my memory is like maybe like 10%. He just landed. And because that's not that exciting. You kind of want him to fail. I think people wanted him to fail. And he did plenty.
Yeah, my little wind-up Evel Knievel thing had a higher success rate.
I had that. Or I had the one with like you pulled the thing out of his back and he was on a motorcycle and you could like jump him off stuff. I had that. Yeah, good stuff. But I thought it was a great name. You know, Skycycle was the name of his rocket that he tried to shoot himself over the Snake River Canyon and failed. So I thought it was a great band name.
Well, Snake River didn't work. You did not make it. Whose fault was it?
It was the engineer's fault, Bob Truax. He made the mistake. The G load on that rocket blew that parachute right out on that launch pad. I did not touch that parachute release button. I had a lot of faith in the guy. He's egotistical, but you got to work with a guy like that that thinks he really knows what he's doing.
Well, here's something. It's always been said that you've broken every bone in your body. Is that true?
No. Don't believe anything that you hear and only half of what you see. It's BS. I have not broken every bone in my body. I broke maybe 30 of them.
So you go from touring Tommy for 500 shows, 500 days, right, into Skycycle, and you got picked up relatively quickly.
Well, 2 years. I think 2 years is a pretty solid amount of time for bands. I think in general, like I had some other, in Los Angeles at that point, everybody I knew was in a band trying to get a record deal. Everybody was, this friend is a band. You go out to see shows and you bring flyers and your friends have flyers because you're promoting your next show. And it was just like such a blast. It was just so great. There's so many talented people and great bands. It was a wonderful, wonderful time. So this would be like 95 when we started. Actually, like around like 94 was kind of like meeting people and trying out different versions of what became Skycycle with different friends and writing songs. And then 95, Halloween night, 95 was our first show in Hollywood. And so it'd be like 2 years of literally the most standard making a band story you can imagine. There was no like, because I'd been on MTV or done the play, there was a kind of like nothing besides people were willing to play with me, maybe that kind of helped. And our manager who helped us, Gary Helsinger, was, knew that stuff. And it was like, oh, this is maybe will help us get a record deal faster or whatever. It didn't. And so after 2 years, we got our record deal with MCA, Music Cemetery of America.
They just never struck me as a good rock and roll label. They were a good catalog label. They had Elvis and shit like that. And Tom Petty was their one big rock act, but they just...
At that point, they had Blink 182, and then they had Tommy Lee's hip-hop project, Methods of Mayhem. Mm. And so when they shelved our album after we'd recorded it, and it was printed, there was cases of CDs that they just never shipped. We found out it was because they wanted to save the budget. They wanted to divert the budget for any Blink 182 stuff they needed, and especially for Tommy Lee's project. So that was why we got dropped.
I want to probe a little bit into that, because some of the articles had said, you know, there was some record label meddling. What does that look like?
I think there always is, at least for me. I'll tell you what it looks like. So we... that one wasn't so bad. We got meddled a lot harder on the Panic Channel, but Skycycle, you know, we think you're wonderful. Let's send you into the studio. We find a producer. Went to there's a punk producer named Rich Mauser, kind of like a weird, evil genius guy. Did everything on tape. We did everything on tape, and we went to the Pasadena Hills for like 2 months. Recorded the songs. You know, we had our album, and then we got the good old fashioned. It was kind of just a standard from what I'd heard from a lot of people. It's like, where's the single? It's like, well, you knew our songs when you hired us or when you gave us the deal. It's like, well, go write some more songs. So wrote a few more songs. And then kind of gave us a more, a guy named Neil Avron, who had some hits under his belt, had us go in and kind of re-record the new stuff with him and then address anything with the existing tracks with this guy. So that's kind of like, the meddling would be like, put these guys in with another person with some new songs and see what happens, and let this new person shave anything, kind of shape the album into what they might think it is, as opposed to the last guy. We did that, and actually had a great time with Rich, Neil Avron, great dude. And we liked the way the album came out. I was really happy with how the album came out. So when it was done, I really didn't feel that it was a byproduct of meddling. I didn't feel like we were being told to do different choruses. Only meddling was like, hey, give us another song. And that was Help Yourself. And that didn't end up being the single anyway. The meddling just kind of squeezed one more song out of it, really. That's it.
That erases my second question, was something that was whether or not releasing your record was punitive because you might have been cranky about having the label metal, but it doesn't sound like you were cranky at all.
No, we were like, oh, we were so like, oh, what do you need? Sure. Cool. Let's do this. When's it coming out? Great. We thought everything was going to go great. You know, we didn't really know that our manager was shielding us from our A&R guy, apparently, who was like threatening that they were going to drop us a lot earlier than they actually did. And we made the bad move of firing our manager. I forget at what point it was, but we kind of came under the impression that if we got rid of our manager, that he was part of the problem with the album not moving forward, and that we were just being signed for 2 years and nothing happened. So we were like, pre-record deal, we were a band for 2 years, signed. And then the next 2 years, we had the album or recorded the album, and then we were kind of in limbo. It was like, well, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? So we like fired our manager. It was really acrimonious, and then got a new manager that didn't really know us. It didn't really work. And all of a sudden, we were just in limbo at the label. And then I just got a call one day. It's like, oh, we're terminating your contract. I'm like, is that possible? Isn't it a record deal? Like, you have to put, like, we did everything we're supposed to do. And then, but the record deal, the record company doesn't have to do anything that they sign for, which is how it is. It's just how it is. So our A&R guy said, you know what? I know it's a bad deal and I'm sorry. It's the higher ups. It's not me. And, but you know what? We're going to give you the album so you can shop it other places, or you can sell it on your own, do whatever you want. I'm going to talk to them. We're going to give it to you. Never happened. I've never been able to get a hold of it as far as shopping it to somebody else or using the songs or merchandise, whatever. It just was basically dead. So, you know, the record business is a really horrible, trashy ass business. And it always has been. And you know, I was just one of those stories. I guess we could have like re-recorded everything, but at that point there was about 6 months left in the life of the band. I just, at that point was pretty over it. Feeling that that could happen again. So, you know, I quit my own band and then just got a job.
I like to joke that the music business is the only business that can make Hollywood look legit and not awful.
Yeah, seriously. Yeah. Makes it look like a, you know, a walkway of dreams, a golden you know, brickway of everything working out by comparison. Yeah, it's just, it's bad. Art and commerce always never will quite match up. Music is such an individual art. It's such a like person usually singing something or portraying something with a few other people making something happen. There's something so, I like to think, true about it that it really goes against the art and commerce. There's much more of a schism and friction than maybe some of the other disciplines.
Please, sir, I want some more.
What?
Please, sir, I want some more.
More?
You've always worked. You know, you went from Skycycle to doing graphic design work. And you did that for a number of years, correct? Self-taught. Mm-hmm. And you're self-taught. You didn't go to art school.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
I knew how to make websites. I knew how to run Photoshop. I knew design. I'd made so many band flyers and for years, right? So that was kind of a, and all that time in Tommy, in the you know, drawing with the trackball of my power book. So, so when I started working entertainment marketing, advertising, my first actual job was building the website for the Hannibal movie in 2000. So wow. I kind of like started doing movie marketing, ads and sites and things like that. And it was that led to what I do now, pretty much.
What made you think that MP3s were really going to be the future?
It seemed like an impossible to ignore. I'm not obviously a financial genius, but I couldn't imagine the ease of use and the utility could ever be ignored. Like the music business was going to have to figure out a way. I didn't know what that way was, but it felt like it was a completely foregone conclusion that the Napster or the music on request was going to be the future. We used to call ourselves, our billing on our website was the internet's own rock band because we had a website very, very early. And so Skycycle was like, really, I was all into like giving the album away. And once we got dropped, I just put it online. It was like, here you go. Just always felt that it was going to happen. And so I don't know how the Napster people found me, but they're like, hey, we'd like to get some musicians who think that this thing, giving away your music, is actually beneficial for sales or beneficial for a band's life. So I, even though we didn't have any like financial success story to trumpet, I just said, hey, I'm all into it. I'd rather people be able to get my music for free and then try to find a way to tour to those people or sell merchandise and make that up as opposed to going through the record business thing again, because I can't stand it and I don't want to be a part of it.
So Skycycle just sort of, you folded up shop.
Yeah, folded up shop.
Sayonara to the music business.
Yeah, I was pretty over it. I was pretty much like next. That was really, I wasn't so much angry as just like really disillusioned and just kind of like took the wind out of my sails and thought like, well, right now I just got to make some money. So let's get to work.
And then lo and behold, you go back into the music business. You go back right into the machine.
Yeah, totally. I forget what the the quote from Hunter S. Thompson. The music business is a cruel and shallow money trench, a long plastic hallway where thieves and pimps run free and good men die like dogs. There's also a negative side. So that was Hunter S. Thompson, and that's perfectly right. So after working at a few different jobs, like building websites and working for, you know, Disney or whoever the hell, Fox Searchlight, building websites and ad campaigns for movies and TV, because that's what happens here in Los Angeles. There's a lot of that kind of work. All of a sudden, I just get hooked up with a friend at that point who is my girlfriend, was Dave Navarro's manager. And I'd met Dave a bunch of times throughout the years. And pretty much Navarro and Grohl were two of the like most friendly right away people and the most friendly people when I would see them again. They'd be the same type of friendly. And I always was hit by like both of them as just being like, man, those are like famous fucking people who are just absolutely one-to-one down to earth. And so I always had a really good feeling about Navarro. And I mean, I just worshiped Jane's Addiction when I was young. I was just like, love the band. So all of a sudden found out that they were in a non-band they were not digging Perry Farrell at that point. There was one of their many, many breakups, and they wanted to keep playing, the three of them. And they just released Strays. They released Strays a little bit ago, before this, and they just wanted to like maybe make some music with somebody else. So all of a sudden I found myself playing with them. We start writing songs and thinking, wow, should we just like turn this into a band? And I was like, whoa, my God, I've got like a day job. And then like on the weekends and at night, I'm playing with, you know, my frigging heroes from Jane's Addiction, like just no full stop. I was just kind of blown away. And I was super like, oh my God, why am I even here? This is so crazy. And we just had like a really good time playing. And I think that they really liked that they were playing with some yokel by comparisons, me, who just wanted to like, all I knew was you go to a garage or you rent a rehearsal space and you show up a few times a week and you have some ideas and you just the basic working machinations of a band, of trying to find, make something happen in the room that made everybody look around and go, oh, that's the shit. Do that again. That kind of incredible excitement that's, you build on that. That's all I knew. And I think they probably just liked that working with me was just pretty simple. And I was definitely not there to like throw attitude because they were my heroes. So personality wise, we all got along super well, super, super well. And you know, that was a blast.
When it starts to have a shape and everything's excited about it, it starts to make things happen in my head, and I start to hear melodies and I start to feel that, oh, this means something. It means something. I don't know what, but I gotta figure it out. And that usually takes me going home and listening to it on the iPod, walking around, listening to the music, and then all of a sudden it'll dawn on me what the song can mean emotionally.
As far as record business stuff, that album, oddly enough, got super meddled with.
Tell me more.
From Capitol Records, you know, he's a fucking asshole. He's just a cheesy. If you were to cast a movie in the 2000s or the 90s, and you casted the cheesiest, slimiest record person you could, I would base it on. It's just a cheese bag.
Like a James Spader character from the.
Great casting. James Spader, but you know, like give him like kind of like hair that's too long for his age, you know, and. A beautiful Capitol Records view and a bunch of guitars that he may or may not play on the wall. I mean, the reality is it's a business. Mm-hmm. The reality is Jane's Addiction still had a record deal. Like when they broke up and they decided to play with me, they still owed Capitol Records. So I get that, you know, financially that he had no interest in some yokel with no commercial appeal, me playing with these guys that he had another album or two that they owed. So I get that Capitol was never truly behind us. They never really like cared about the music. I don't mean they in the collective. I'm sure there's some people in the tower that probably loved it and wanted us to succeed, but he didn't. He definitely didn't. This was, I think to him, it was like an indulgence. Let them do an album with this guy. And then Jesus Christ, can you guys just get back together and let's make some money and get on tour? Because that's what my job is making the people that I sign record deals make those albums. So, but he was just personally just a real cheesy bastard. I had such an attitude about how they made us kind of like rewrite it or influenced me to look at the possibility of rewriting it for commercial appeal so that it would make the rest of the album have be able to get heard. You know, it was kind of the Faustian bargain of dealing with Howard Benson, who has just had hits with My Chemical Romance. And I really like that album. So I'm like, oh my God, we're going to work with him. And man, that guy ended up being, that was like one of those Faustian things. And I think I failed to, on a certain level. It was like, I knew from Capitol wasn't into the band. I knew I loved our album. We all loved our album. They made us record it again. We'd already recorded. They made us record it again with a different producer. And then worked with Howard Benson on finding the singles, right? So it was kind of like, there are two songs he was going to re-record. And he's like, I want you to think about doing this part as the chorus and repeating it over and over and over again. And like, don't have it happen twice in the song. Have it happen over and over again. And I was like, you know, this is, I mean, I've had this song for years. We played this song. This is already like a thing. It just like is this thing. And I remember he was like, how many hits do you have? How many hits do I have? Do you want to do this or not? And he was like a straight dick about it. It was kind of like either do this or like the session's over. And I was alone in the studio. It wasn't like all of us sitting there. Like it was kind of like Steve working with this guy. And I said, yeah, let's do it. Let's see how it sounds. Let's see how it sounds. And I ended up kind of like liking it on some level and another level going, I should have just left it the way it fucking was. You know, why do we have to re-record the whole album? Both versions are fucking great. I love that album. But that's meddling, you know. It seems every 20 years there's kind of a beat where it's like, well, rock comes back or making your own music comes back and does this thing. And it didn't happen this time. It hasn't happened. You know, it's just not.
No, it hasn't happened yet. It's just amazing. The 90s were the halcyon days of the record industry and music as a music fan, you know, because there was so much happening and so much of it was good. There was shit.
Yep.
But so much of it was good.
But so much good. Oh, my God. It was ridiculous. Yeah. You just expected great stuff to be on MTV and expected to find new stuff that you're like, whoa, like it wasn't commercial crap. You know, it was selling commercially, but it was good. You know, like Soundgarden would be like in the top 10. It was just incredible. And at that point, the top 10 made sense. It was like people actually went to a place and purchased something or stood in the line to get something. It was very, you know I sound like, you know, old dude, you know, pining for the old days, but the old days were rad. They were great.
Yes, they were great. I remember queuing up at midnight to get the latest U2 record, Achtung Baby, in 1990, I think that was.
Yeah. I was in line for a Appetite for Destruction on Sunset Boulevard at Tower Records midnight. Yeah, I was like, and we took it and we went back to somebody's apartment and all sat there and didn't say a word and played it and thought.
Yep.
I mean, it was like, good shit.
So Skycycle, gone. Panic Channel, that ever going to happen again?
I don't think so. I mean, we talk every once in a while, but you know, they're back playing with Jane's Addiction now. And we talked, you know, there was like a few years after, like I pretty much broke it up. I just decided to move to New York. I felt like I was done with Los Angeles. And I felt like Capitol was going to be out. Our management was going to drop us. The first album didn't sell. And so that was kind of going to be up for us. I just had this bad feeling about it. So I kind of killed it. It was kind of a little bit, not passive aggressive, but as opposed to sticking it out and trying, I was just like, I'm done, which is kind of one of my failures. I think sometimes I just go next channel, next thing. I'm not going to think about it anymore. So there's probably more music we could have made. I love that album, even though we got meddled with a bit on the single. I just knew so many people who didn't even get the shot that I got and that other people did. And it's kind of, you know, it's a shame. It was just like, you know, it's there's a lot of talent out there.
There absolutely is.
There's a lot of the most honest, true people in the music business that are just trying to like, that love that feeling when they've written a song or they play a part in a song and they look at each other and go, oh my God, like we need to play this for people. That is such a pure, true thing. And there's a lot of people that I think love to be around music because it's exciting.
Yeah.
But there's just some real slime balls, you know? On that happy note, thank you.
Steve, thank you for the time. I appreciate it.
It was good talking with you.
Thanks, man.
Of course.
Take care.
All right, bye-bye.
The songs you heard on this podcast were Last Girl on Earth from the Skycycle EP, Breathing Water, Help Yourself from the Skycycle debut album, Ones and Zeros, and She Won't Last by the Panic Channel from their album One. All of Steve's music is available to stream wherever you stream your favorite music. Many thanks to Steve Isaacs and Jeff Calhoun.
Our theme song is Rocket Sled by Blip. Abandoned Albums was recorded at Thunderlove Studios. Produced and written by Keith R. Higgins. Engineered and mixed by Steve Beasley with the help of Mike Hunt. Edited by AJ Royce.
Original music by Mike Pellegrino.
If you like what you've heard, please be sure to subscribe and leave us a rating. It really does help. Thanks for listening.
At Twitter, we are at Abandoned Albums. And on Instagram, we are at Abandoned_Albums.
Grazie.
Daily Leaf. Rob Janicki. Mike Pellegrino. Therina Vella. Ronnie Barnett. S.W. Loudon. Michael Janicki. Peyton Janicki. And our executive producer.
This is Thunderlove.
And now, until we meet again next time, I remain as always obediently yours.
Abandoned Albums is a production of Paw Print Media.